Okay, so I want to talk about two things on this little slide here. The first one is kind of a general observation about rewards and what makes the reinforcement learning MDP problem different from the supervised learning problems that we did before. And that's this notion of not just rewards, but this notion of delayed rewards. So what do I mean by that? Well, so if you think about the way we've set up this kind of problem like we have here where we're trying to start in this little bottom left-hand square and wind our way up into this plus one, there's really this notion of sequences of actions. So in the reinforcement learning context and all the things that we're talking about, at least in the foreseeable future, there's this sort of problem where you take some action and that puts you in some place, and then you take another action and that puts you in some place, and then you take another action and that puts you in some place, and maybe it puts you at a place where you get plus one. Or maybe it puts you at a place where you get minus one. And what really is going on here is this idea that you take actions that will set you up for other actions that will set you up for other actions, and only then do you know how good those particular actions you took were. So this reward is not just an idea of getting a reward at every state, it's an idea of getting delayed reward. So you don't know how your immediate action is going to lead to things down the road. So let me give you a concrete example about that. So have you ever played chess?
Sure.
So let's say we played a long game of chess and maybe it took 60, 61, 62 moves. And then at the end, I win the game. So what do you know about the way you played that game?
That I probably made a bad decision around the time when I decided to play chess against you.
That's possible. But maybe you made a good decision and you kept making good decisions and you only messed up at the very last move when you could have mated me, but you didn't.
I see. Well, my experience in playing chess is that usually that's not what happens. Usually it's not that I make a bad move and then there's a problem. It's usually I make a move that I think is reasonable that only later I discover put me in a position where I can't possibly do anything good.
Right. Well, that's actually the game that I played in New York many, many years ago that I lost was exactly like that. The game went on for like literally 100 moves. I really lost the game on the third move.
Oh.
I made a mistake. I transposed two moves because it was a new opening that I was just learning. And I knew at the time that I screwed up. I played beautiful chess from that point on. But the truth is the other player had a positional advantage from that point on that I could never overcome. So I lost the game, but not because I played poorly for, 80 moves. It's because I played poorly for one move, and that move happened to be fairly early. So this is this notion of delayed reward, that I played this long game of chess, and maybe it's I played well and I screwed up in the end. Maybe I played a mediocre game, but I had a couple of brilliant moves and that's why I won. Or maybe I played very well in the beginning, poorly at the end, or the other way around. And the truth is you don't really know. All you know is that you've taken a bunch of actions. You get rewards, signals back from the environment, like I won the game or I lost the game. And then you have this problem of figuring out of all the actions that I took, what was the action that led to me ultimately winning or losing or getting whatever reward that I got at the end of a sequence. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it seems like that could be really challenging. You probably need your own like sportscaster listening and commenting.
Yeah, and in fact, the sportscaster who's listening and commenting, at least in the MDP world, is in fact the sequence of rewards that you get and the sequence of states that you see. Right? It really is sort of a play-by-play. In this state, took this action, got this reward. And you want to take all of that and then figure out whether this was a good action, your first action, or a poor action, or your second action was good or poor, and so on and so forth. Now, contrast that with supervised learning. So in supervised learning, what you would be getting is, well, I was in this state, this first state, and then this was the proper action I was supposed to take, let's say action 17. And your goal then is just simply to learn a function from states to specific actions. That's how the supervised learning problem is set up, right?
Yeah, exactly.
In this particular case, you're in some state, you take some action, and you get some reward for the action that you took, or maybe the state that you ended up in, or something. And you get a sequence of these state action reward triples, and then ultimately you have to figure out, for the given states you were in, what was the action you took that helped to determine, or actions you took that helped to determine the ultimate sequence of rewards that you saw? Perhaps this one plus one or this minus one that you got at the end. This is a really difficult problem. It's got its own name. It's called the credit assignment problem. And in fact, because we're talking about a sequence of events over time, we typically refer to this sort of problem as the temporal credit assignment problem. Does that make sense, Michael?
Yeah, that's really cool. Although I guess it's credit, but also blame, right?
Well, credit and blame, blame is just the minus of credit. So without loss of generality, assume that credit can assume a negative or positive value.
And yet when I go to the supermarket, they never say blame or credit.
Well, that's just because they don't understand the technical terms.
Got it.